how dirty I get my hands for you people. It's just a mess after every lecture.
Okay. I say okay a lot. I'm sorry about that. Just trying to get through this. So we left off last time with this benefit of posing very simple, pure questions that are in dimensionless form and end up getting a very simple system. So recall we were studying and we got there from very natural questions that we were asking about scales of dimensions. So if this is my x and then the y, I had some boundary here, meaning an h, right, of a thickness of fluid film, and this h is much, much smaller than the length of travel for that the fluid has to get through. A bunch of assumptions had gone down, and we derived this very simple system to solve. Where at the base, I had a no-slip condition, because I'm imagining this being a solid wall. And then I leave the top a variable boundary condition because I want to be able to solve more problems in one go. So that's where you then have this other system, right, where this is 1 because y divided by h, when it's equal to h, it equals 1. And then we had right here some reference. So if this has some velocity, right, this could be a 0 value as well. So let's call this a u infinity, right? In non-dimensional things, in terms, this would look like this. So you have the far field velocity, and then non-dimensionalized by this natural scale of velocity here. So one trick I sort of implicitly did here is I never actually gave a velocity for the problem at hand. All right, we don't even have, you know, there's a bunch of issues on picking these velocity scales, especially in turbulence. People argue about what's a better velocity to scale things by. But for our cases, we can search for some by solving the independent problems, I think. So solve one with, solve it for 0 and then solve it for some velocity. And then there's this aspect of that we non-dimensionalized pressure by some reference pressure, and we just kind of left it as a variable, right? Remember, we had these situations where we could have, right, you could non-dimensionalize with this. You got the choice of, right, a linear relationship, right? So this is lubrication, but I consider them the exact same pressure scale. Because when epsilon is equal to 1, I would return this viscous-dominated pressure scale. There was also a surface tension one, but we don't need to go into that at this point in the class. So there's right, your pressure scale is arbitrary and can be each of these. So P naught. All right. And also remember, very importantly, we had this conclusion about the fully developed. Now, before you maybe saw fully developed in the equations of motions, you had this idea of the the velocity profile was not changing in the x direction. And that's stated for you, and I just say that's how it's got to be, right? So going back there, right, if you wrote out this x momentum, this is a continuation of last one, so maybe you kind of pick up where you left off. If we go back to that x momentum equation we had, we picked up one of the small parameters here, right, and I had a u star. So I picked up a small parameter here, okay? And then on the other side, right, if we did choose the viscous dominated pressure sides, right, we would then have a curvature term for the velocity profile, and then this pressure term for the velocity profile. I have that, right? Yeah, and we would pick up also the same Reynolds number here in the non-dimensional pressure in the x. Okay, so I'm kind of going backwards because I want to maybe, how advanced this stuff can be. You can even see this stuff happen before your eyes, right? So remember that you had this concept of an entrance length for that region, and they had this Reynolds relationship. Well, by golly, wouldn't you be amazed to see that it's still just popping up right here. So the idea of this term not being negligible, because this derivative term, again, if you forget what happens after non-dimensionalization, right, every derivative term we're going to say looks like 1 by the definition of this scales of the problem we have. So I'm allowed to do that at least. So then you have this thing of, okay, so I have to consider this term, right? I can scale the u, right? This term, right? This term is okay. That's still going to be 1. But this is going to be an issue where I can't ignore this term, even in the one-dimensional case, if these things balance. Right? So if this is not negligibly 0, then that would mean, right, this is going to be on the same order. All right? So then epsilon really looks like this. And then what do you get except this relationship? Right? I believe that is the right one too. Right? Cuz from here. Yeah, so this is sort of an entrance length is going to be proportional to like your thickness with Reynolds number and then the h, the thickness. So maybe you've seen this before, you have this proportionality thing with a hydraulic diameter, and you have this relationship of being linearly proportional to the Reynolds number. So that's still going to be here, right? I just did complete non-dimensionalization. I treated things like 1, but then I still have this issue where even in my order 1 system, right, I would need to consider this term if these balance. Well, that's just nothing but saying this. If your x length scale is on the same order as the Reynolds and your hydraulic diameter, right, or it could be the radius. I'm using h for this 2D flow, but you could imagine you could have a delta r, right? Then you see this, right? And again, remember this too. It's helpful to remember this tilde squiggly line. It really means, right, one width, right, it really means if you go by its definition, this, which is sort of, you know, you get an equality right here, which seems like a good conclusion, but what it's kind of tricky because, well, I can conclude that it is equal to a constant multiplied by this. I have no idea actually what this constant is. So that's sort of a problem. But at the same time, right, these tilde symbols are really instructions or programs of how to do an experiment, what you should be experimenting for. So then, right, what you then do is you then run this experiment and you measure velocity happening throughout this domain, right, and you keep on increasing. Right? If I measure point by point the velocity that's happening in my flow, I can run this experiment, and then I can maybe determine what this C naught is. And after enough experimentations have been done, people have affirmed this, where that if it is laminar, right, I think it's like about 0.05 hydraulic diameter Reynolds number. So this is for the laminar case. Right, so if I have really a slow enough flow, then my entrance regime, right, where physically I can make the assumption that I don't have to worry about the advecting, right, about the changing velocity profile down the x direction, ends up being like this. And you still get that from the non-dimensional scale relationships we have there. Amazing, right? I think that's pretty cool to see. You know, this isn't so mysterious, let's say now, where in your book you would go to, how do I get my entrance length? And you see there's some relationship. Well, now hopefully you understand where that term comes from and where these terms come from. The linear proportionality being this Reynolds expression. Now for the turbulent case, that's tricky, right? Because it ends up not being related to linearly to your Reynolds number. It ends up having to have some sort of other relationship. But I still think you can reason this concept out because, I mean, if this is getting smaller and smaller and smaller and right, or larger and larger and larger, right? Okay, so if this blows, right, these terms are going to die out and go nowhere, right? So you're getting really, really large right there. So writing the same x momentum equation, except this time we do that maybe double pressure that I had. And that popped up here. And this is in the x. Remember, there was an epsilon down here in that non-dimensional operation. But since I picked up an epsilon in the non-dimensional gradient operator, they cancel out, and I then get this relationship. So this is now my non-dimensional pressure. And this is kind of balancing both. And I'm trying to sort of reason this limiting process of keeping track of a Reynolds number. OK? So again, this was for laminar because it was always dominated by the slow frictional forces that happen in the liquid. But right, I could make this pressure scale, right, if maybe I'm in some transitional in-between. I mean, and then certainly if Reynolds number is actually infinite, then I'm really just in this regime, and then the epsilon is matched. Certainly that's not there, and you get the Euler's equations. Okay. So now you have this idea of when Reynolds numbers is really blowing up, I have no way to measure that, right? But I want to see, like, I want to investigate. I still want to investigate large Reynolds numbers, right? Even to a measurable degree. Now, if you're running an experiment, you want to really ramp this relationship up and still make some conclusion about this entrance length. Okay, I say okay, summa, too much in these lectures. Right, so then still this balance has to play out where now I have to compare. I mean, the epsilon's going to be small. The epsilon's still a small number. Right, the epsilon didn't care the epsilon's just dimensions. It just came from the capital omega. That can't care at all. But what can have some effect now is this. So in some way of still, right, as this gets larger and larger and larger and larger, having to still track it, you maybe come to this idea, well, what if I look at a power relationship of this? So one way I think of this is if R is, right, if your Reynolds is really, really large, one way to make that a small number, right, is to look at, right, the log Reynolds number. And that really, right, the log, you know, the log reduces a very large number, right? Log of log greatly reduces that number. But it's still maybe sort of a check you could do. So measuring this process in terms of 1 over the Reynolds number, right? I mean, you could think of this as this. I mean, I'm not making quite sense, but I'm just saying you can almost see if I'm trying to measure very, very large Reynolds numbers, one way you could do that is to run your experiments and vary the Reynolds numbers at very high levels, keep the same aspect ratio, but in order to get a better, right, in order to get a better, right, to be able to zoom into this incredibly small number, right, you could look at right, because a 1 over a relationship would make your very tiny number like bump it up to a number that's almost 1. You can just do that on pen and paper to see. So something tricky happened, but at least if you were doing the experiment, right, you could, you know, this is right. You could see when this small tiny number balances the Reynolds number close up. So then it's sort of the same process, right, where you have this, and I want this now to balance not just 1 over the Reynolds number, really, but this one over p. Again, I'm just trying to maybe show you where maybe these mysterious formulas can come from, because they can come from just this scale, and something weird happened where somehow the deeper and deeper, right, the larger and larger Reynolds, the larger and larger Reynolds number is getting, somehow this can't be, somehow you're trying to zoom into when this effect is still slightly there, and then you'll get something like this, right? And then you can even get that turbulent turbulent relationship, right, where now, again, you have some number here. It ends up being, I think, 4.45. I've seen just 5 every once in a while. And then I have an H or a hydraulic diameter. And then you search for this P. What P does the best, regardless of how large this is? And it ends up being 1/6, I've seen, 1/6. So again, just from the scales, then you're just trying to balance these terms, and then this one's a little weirder, right? Because now you're trying to keep the Reynolds number, right? You're trying to keep the Reynolds number part of the analysis, even though it's a zero number. Because it's very turbulent, meaning you have an extremely large Reynolds number, if you're still trying to keep the analysis in there, well, you could then look at this 1 over P of the value. And then those balancing, right, means this. I mean, another way to think of it as, another way maybe to think about it is, right, is when epsilon to a P, right, will balance. Well, right. But this one's kind of weird, like, so, I mean, this one's kind of weird just because the epsilon with a P, like, I don't think that really changes, so why would you raise the P? Right, so think of this way, it was epsilon, if you have a raise to the P value, I already know that the epsilon is much, much less than 1. It was my height over L. Clearly, it has to go further in the L direction than it is the thickness of the film. So what value of P would I attain that extremely tiny 1 over Reynolds number relationship? And then you run those experiments and you get that entrance length where that would still matter. We won't do any more of that in the class just because I'm not comfortable with too much of turbulence. Obviously, there's an expert in turbulence out there. You're probably screaming at me for doing that. But I more so am trying to emphasize how you can just get a lot from doing the scale stuff. And if it is non-dimensional, you still conclude the same things, right? You no longer have to really take for granted the fact that in a laminar case, that the entrance length, right, right. You no longer, I think, now you would no longer now have to accept that. You would see why that's the case, right? You can feel why that's the case because that, right? I have to consider the advection term if this number is somehow balancing the 1 over Reynolds number, and that's when this would happen. Okay, so that's just a little. I was amazed when I saw those things because there's just things that I saw and I just took them for granted. And you never should do that. You should always ask more and more questions of why. Why is that? Why is that term there? I don't want to just take. Okay, so now this is the one time we're going to do it where I'll solve this system. And I think it's not the best. Whatever. Okay, so now we're going to solve this very, very simple system that we have, right? It's an ODE, and we prescribe boundary conditions to it. And we have a shearing plate. This could be zero, or it could be a positive value. And now, right, so then you get. So you integrate this equation twice. And get your classic, just boring stuff. And then you apply boundary conditions to solve for these coefficients. Right? So you get, right. I'm not even excited when I do this stuff anymore because there are great computers that just do these calculations for you. So this would mean that it's 0, 0. So that means that this number has to be 0 to satisfy this boundary condition. Hopefully you've done this before, but I'll just do it. I'm doing it explicitly for you. So now you have this boundary condition where it's 1. So I have 1 there, 1 there. This would then be 2. I should. And then that's 1 plus this is left over. And this has to equal this ratio. Okay, then from here, you can see this has to be then nothing too complex. This is we're just still in algebra world, which is a great world to be in. So then you put your then you just plug your integration constants back in, and you get this nice general solution. So I have this contained in the minus. So then I have this u. So then this is positive. Okay. Still not done, though. Because we never picked this velocity scale. Right? Even when we did the entire non-dimensionalization, we just did this thing where we said, well, this is going to scale like this. I never told you what it was, right? It just is some value. But actually selecting this velocity value, what did I say? It came from initial conditions or it came from a boundary condition. So I have one here, right? Again, always remember, I'll put that in red, right? Look for them in the boundary conditions or the initial conditions. First do that. If you've well formulated your problem well enough, right, then the scales have to come from there. Maybe you remember last term I went on about this idea of the initial condition is really what's giving you the velocity scale. And then there could be a boundary velocity like we see right here. So there's an additional scale of velocity coming from the boundary itself. That coming from that relative to a surface, at the wall, there's still no slip. So don't forget to look at the boundary. Right? Don't just make them up, I think. You could wait. I mean, it's creative, but you can make better educated guesses or do trickery if you start with your boundary conditions and initial conditions. There's still an issue of internal scales for the problem, right? And that can be shown just doing a dimensional version of this problem. Okay? So this is the totally general system, right? But you could just write, so then this would really be the dimensional problem. Again, so now there's no more stars. If you were to just take the exact same system and make it dimensional, well, if you undo your Reynolds number, you have this viscosity term right here. Here's the pressure gradient. And then you'd have boundary conditions here. So naturally, sort of right here, we just haven't assigned even the pressure scale at this point. But there's also a velocity scale internal to your problem for this one. And this is the sense, right? And this is really trickery. Because if I make this now zero, if I have the no slip, I do still have a velocity scale. You just have to find it. And that's because this is a constant value and the velocity is right there. So again, if I have no scales, right? The boundary conditions now gave me no scales to deal with, so I can't use them, right? I have no scale to associate for a velocity. I looked in the boundary condition for a velocity scale, couldn't find one. Have no initial conditions because it's a boundary value problem, so can't do it there. So then you go to this trickier process of then looking for the structure of the equation itself to find a velocity scale. Well, from here, right? Right, so this is this. I've just pulled the dimensions out of here. I have a scale for y, right? Scale for y being h. That was naturally there from the geometry of the problem. But right, you see that if you had zero boundary conditions, you had no velocity scale. But you can find one internal to the problem itself by doing this just trick. You know this is a constant value because we did that right, continuity, a consistency condition shows you that. You don't just take on the chin that like, oh, it's a linear pressure gradient going downward. I showed you that this has to be a constant value. Now you have the viscosity, and then you can really find it, right? So now, okay, well, I have one being this. So there's a velocity scale as well. So I have now two competing velocity scales. I have this boundary velocity, it's a shearing velocity, and then I have this internal pressure-driven velocity. So a scale that could retain both of them, right, is really the sum of both. Right? And you can think of this as, well, what's a velocity scale that sort of encapsulates everything I've talked about? Right? Well, you could think of just, well, what if I pick my velocity scale to just be the average of these, right? So I have this. There's nothing wrong with that, right? Clearly, I have two velocities competing for winning on the scale. So if I take just the boundary, I could take the boundary shearing velocity and then an internal scale to the problem, take an average of them. That's a good decent scale, you could say. And doing things like this is also a good trickery. Why does it look good if you do something like that? Well. So I mean, I still like this one, right? I mean, you could still run this, and you could do this process where you reverse back from the non-dimensional pressure gradient. We might not have to, right? You know, because an equivalent sort of thing is saying in this non-dimensional solution I have, I want these two terms to really balance out. I don't want one of them to, right? I want one of them to be big and one of them to be small. I kind of want to be able to view both of them exactly at the same time. So on this side, right, that would be saying I want remember this is and this is now a non-dimensional pressure gradient. So if this is the way you're going about it now, you're trying to ask then when would these things balance? So, right, I want this term to be like, I want it to be around here, so that gives you the same scale. This to be around one is that, right, I want this number to look like one, just like this value. Well, that would mean that the scale would have to be on the shearing velocity scale. So now what about this thing? Well, you just have to back up the non-dimensionalization that you did. Right, because this is a pressure, right, so a non-dimensional pressure, you would have the dimensional pressure gradient divided by a reference pressure that you had, and then L. Okay, you could keep the 1, 2 there, but in the scale world, you could just throw it away. It's an L, so then there's a pressure gradient. So now you have this pressure gradient, right? And here's, then, is that idea of what do you want or what do you expect from the physics, right? Because on this situation, if I know that this is, well, the pressure, it's really sort of scaling like a, right, a 1 over L relationship. Or no, actually, we had the lubrication theory, right? We were doing this one, okay, where this epsilon, but epsilon, right, was H over L, so I have an H squared, and then the L pops in there. Again, I use this lubrication one because if epsilon is equal to 1, that will lump down to just the, to just, right, mu times the velocity scale divided by a length scale. There's just a non-dimensional term scaling this pressure. So you go around that way, and then you would see that this, right, that this is scaling like a okay, so that goes away, and then you have these things, you want these things to balance. So then here you again have, right, well then this should then, right, so this velocity scale should be right, the velocity is scaling like the pressure gradient across in the x direction. So I do this, I did this to show you this cyclical pattern, right? You could do everything in a non-dimensional form and then back it up to find scales, like I'm doing right here. Or you could just maybe do the dimensional one and then non-dimensionalize your simplified equation and then do things from there. Time? Okay, not that bad. Okay, let me make that clear again. Notice what I had done to look at these two velocity scales were sort of separate, right? You can just simplify the dimensional Navier-Stokes and then non-dimensionalize, right? Or you can non-dimensionalize the full Navier-Stokes and then, or you can simplify, right? Or you can non-dimensionalize the full Navier-Stokes equations and then consider scales. So this was that cyclical thing I was trying to, I made that diagram of, right? It's sort of, one informs the other, but they're equivalent. It's almost maybe a preference, I think, for fluids people. My preference, I quite enjoy to go from the full Navier-Stokes completely non-dimensional and then make statements about this non-dimensional equation. And then if I get a simplified solution, then dimensionalize it and then make statements about the flow. But there are plenty of people that just go straight to a simplified version and then non-dimensionalize their simplified Navier-Stokes. I just like looking at the total system and killing terms off that way. Okay. So then if you do make this pressure scale like this, well, not pressure scale, right? We also need it to be a negative. This has to be a negative, actually, in the pressure. It's a negative in the pressure because if you have a negative pressure gradient, you need a positive velocity. So you do need to keep this negative there just to keep consistent with the idea that positive direction corresponds to a negative pressure gradient slope. So that's where a negative will come into. So we can have a minus here. Okay, and then you have this issue that once we divide, this thing could be zero, actually. So even still, the solution does look the solution will look a bit better though with this normalized scale, right? Because here, I would have a U naught, and then I have this U naught. So now the next trick is this tool bag, right? Keep in your tool bag, making expressions look pretty. And so maybe this isn't obvious, but again, I'm doing this example so you just see this once. Okay, I can write this expression, right? If I take out, let's say, I go 1 over, I'll multiply this expression by 1. This number is just 1, so I'm allowed to do that. I'm just looking at now a ratio of two different velocities, and that's like a single parameter I can keep track of. So I'm really, it's a reduction of things I have to model with, but now this term would then look like 1 over 1 minus, let's call it phi. So that's this term right here. And then this term, I can likewise do a sim, where I could do the exact same thing, where I now divide everything by 1 over, right, divide by the 1 over infinity here, keep talking. It's so quiet and boring. Okay, now what I have is the same ratio, only this situation is going down. Right? So these terms end up looking nice because they can retain a limit. So now I have a very, very general solution to this whole problem. Right? It's scaling by this. And then I'll have this additional 1/2. Flip this. I did this negative flip to retain, so that I still have a negative velocity with this positive pressure gradient. You have to have a flip of the pressure gradients for this to work out and still give you a general conclusion. You actually just make the whole thing negative too, actually. So another way to do this is actually just scale everything by the net, right? It's actually just scale everything by the negatives, right? This be negative. Right, and then you have a situation where it would look like this. It's really a matter of choice. Maybe you'd see why I'd actually formulate it like this, where a scale doesn't care about a negative one value, just cares about magnitude. So in terms of magnitudes, this is fine to do, and then I don't have a divisor by zero situation on my hands. But then what's nice is, what does this phi thing represent that we just defined by making the math look pretty, right? Well, phi has a natural interpretation, right, as this ratio of velocities. And it's non-dimensional, so on the top I would have, right, this pressure-driven pressure, and then on the bottom, right, and then dividing is this boundary velocity, which is caused by this shearing top layer, right? The shearing could be a plate that's being pulled, or it could be an abstraction of just like maybe a far field velocity that's causing some shear going this way in an average. You gotta be careful with those things, but it works for. Right? So now that's a nice interpretive parameter we can have. And it's nice because you can see that in the limits, this thing gives you both solutions even. Okay, so if I have if phi becomes extremely large, I should recover just that classic Poiseuille flow that you have and you did where just the quadratic, right, where it would just look like, I'll just draw these velocity profiles, right? So you can have the thing, you can have this scale and limits now, where it should look like this, right? As the phi parameter goes to infinity, and it would look like this as the phi parameter jumps down to zero. Right? So that's what I mean by solving an infinite amount of problems in this very simple setup. Keep in mind, all we had done was just tricky things with scales, just saying, what's the velocity scale, and search for boundaries and initial conditions. But it's still a fairly simple problem, right? I just had to do two integrations and then play with integration constants. But you get so much information now out of one solution. And I even now just have one parameter that's going to tell me, right, what my velocity profile looks like. Right, right, I love, if you have something like this, right, it's just good to, right, when you get totally non-dimensional solutions and equations, right, then it's a great time to really plot them in like Desmos or something to like kind of see how the functional form of the velocity profile looks. So I recommended using Desmos on the website just because it's just really fast and quick to maybe check your math solution. And then almost all of the physics now is combined and contained purely within this non-dimensional phi thing we defined, right? So I've solved all the 2D Poiseuille flows. I've solved all the I'm really sorry to any French person watching this. I can't seem to do it. But again, you get all of those classical solutions. So I just did all of that undergrad solution in just this one solution right here. I mean, and now with this non-dimensional term, we can then move on and calculate things based even on that, right? So a quantity of interest that usually we care about. So now let's think about quantities of interest. Interest. Okay? It's a phrase that's used a lot in at least engineering I've seen, right? So sometimes they're just called QOI, I've seen sometimes. It's a way to keep track of this idea of what do you want, right? And the thing about fluid dynamics, right, that it's maybe hard to get across is the fact that these things are dependent based on the velocity field. So, right, if you find the velocity field, if you have solved the problem, you can then start determining quantities of interest. Such as, right, the biggest one, the two biggest ones being shear at the wall and then a flow rate, right? And these have mathematical descriptions. If it's a Newtonian fluid, right, we can calculate this because this is the definition now of a Newtonian fluid. This would be shear at the wall, right? Again, appreciate the fact that it's a derived quantity because we first need to figure out what the velocity field was. If I know that velocity field, I can tell you shear at the wall. And this becomes more complex when we'll see like a similarity solution, et cetera. When the Blasius, oh, I'm getting ahead of myself, right? But the idea is your quantities of interest are derived from your velocity profile. So work needs to be done to get the velocity profile, and then you can like do things, right? I don't really know of cases where someone's asking you, like, tell me when it's going this fast. You know, they more care about this shear at the wall because you don't want the right corners on pipes, et cetera, to burst, or you don't want the forces inside the internal pipes to be too large, right? And then for a flow rate, right, a flow rate, if it's a constant velocity profile, right, is a velocity volumetric flow rate defined by Q. So if you have a constant velocity profile, you maybe have seen this as the area times the velocity. Just some constant velocity. But if you have the velocity field and you can actually integrate it, this is an integral right now. This is actually encapsulated as an integral, right? This is, that's your velocity field now. So it's an integral expression. So if you have the actual velocity function, you can now calculate the flow rate, right? And you can even make these non-dimensional, right? I mean, in non-dimensional terms, you could have a flow rate star, right? I mean, this can be integrating from 0 to 1 right, so the dA. So this would be a per unit width, actually, one, right? So maybe I'll keep that up there, this idea that really, once you get your velocity profile, these calculations are usually very helpful. And there are other ones too, depending on the problem you have, but appreciating the fact that you do need the velocity field to then get those properties. And any way you can model the function, you could get some idea of what the velocity profile is. Okay, great. So that was, right, that's a continuously infinite amount of problems solved by using non-dimensionalization. So let's keep going with this type of a problem where we've retained our 2D problem statement right here. Okay. But then we get to, you know, let's loosen that steady state situation, right? So maybe every time before you make this statement that this is equal to zero, that I'm at steady state of flow. But now let's see what you need to do if you don't have that. So this is a dynamic problem. Right? So these can become tricky, really, in the right, in sort of what you're trying to ask or model about. So it could be really the same setup, but you really want to keep around another. You want to keep around the time derivative term. So this is something called Raleigh's problem. Yeah, Raleigh's problem, and it's a flat plate in an infinite media now. So I now don't have this h. So keep that in mind, that the h is now not anymore. In terms of the scales, right, now I have this y blowing up to infinity. So here's an x. It's a flat plate, we'll say. Here's y. And I have this situation where I'm just trying to look at how the fluid will adjust to an instantaneous motion of this plate, right? So right here, I'm trying to look at what happens to the velocity field with an impulse motion of the plate, right? So let's say at time equal to actually zero, dimensional or non-dimensional, right, I would have my velocity field be zero. It's zero the other one. Oh god. Practice, and you still mess this stuff up. That's bad exercise. Still liquid, and then over time. Okay. So this is the right. Okay, so right now I have zero. So I start off in completely still liquid. And then for all time greater than zero, I'm moving at a constant velocity. This is right. So now this bound, right? So now this is an initial condition of u. Right. Boundary condition. Initial condition, boundary condition. And then we have some other situation that we want to say of what happens to the velocity field as I go up in my field of fluid right now. So that's more assignment of this problem that we have. Okay, in this problem, I also want to say that I don't have a pressure gradient imposed on the problem. All right, I'm just going to be done with this one. Maybe before we get before any thought of like non-dimensional problem, again, I like this process of, it's nice too. So here's the surface. There's some effective length where surface tension things affect you, and then it cuts off. And then let's say there's an area when it's no longer this, so there's some initial jolt. So this would be, let's say, a fish underwater that's initially still, and then immediately goes right to some constant velocity rate. Or you also could do the exact same problem and think about acceleration. So a fish could be swimming at a constant velocity rate and then have a jolt, right? So it accelerates instantaneously, which is also a change in your velocity. You can formulate the same problem this way. So this is really sort of asking, in still liquid, if my little fishy starts to go forward, and if I zoom in really close to the fish scales, right? What is the liquid? What does the velocity field look like around the fish's around the fish skin surface? Right? How much energy would need to be? How much energy does a fish need to have to swim to accelerate within this medium? That's an important question. But this is what you would formulate it this way. You would zoom in really close, so at least you have some length scale in this y. Again, even though my coordinate system is right here, so this is the y system, and if I zoomed in, it would look like a flat plate, right? Zoom into Mr. Fishy, and you're zooming in so far that it looks like a flat plate with the y dimension going up like that. The only thing about this problem is that this y scale is going to go up, 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 all the way to the surface of the lake. So that's where you have this y right going off to infinity, because I need to have the y scale go up to infinity. I need to have some still liquid and approach this area right here. If you remember this, this is sort of how I tell myself that maybe there's sort of a situation like this. Right, so I'm trying to get back up to here where it's still liquid above. So that formulates this y scale here. And then the x scale also could be further, right, could go continue outward and outward. Right. So I'm going to run through this quickly because I feel I had done like a very step-by-step job initially in the first example, and maybe just show you the benefit of this stuff is this, right, the scale and system that you derive after you do approximations. It's this. It's really just the exact same system. This is the dimensional one. Importantly, you recover that the pressure gradient in this area deep to the liquid is exactly the same. So again, think about it, right? Right here, right in line, there's a pressure right here, which is rho gh, if this is right down here. And then on the same constant line, I would have also rho gh. So between these two points, there's no pressure gradient, so there's no additional pressure gradient flow caused by this. You can do this exact same problem with a pressure gradient, too. We won't do that. So right in my model of this fish swimming there, it's the thing that accelerated and still liquid. Still liquid meaning only pressure gradients are in the y and they're gravitational. It's recovered from this equation in the y momentum with these scales. And then what else? What the other one I have written down is, oh man, great, it was lost. Everything's in there. And then again, you have that this be zero as well. So there's an issue, though, on these infinite scales. The issue of the infinite scales being you can't say now, I can't say that. But I want to look at this y variable. I don't have now an h I could put here. Recall before we had this value scaled as h, right? And even the x dimension we had scale as l. You could still keep this l, by the way. It would just need to be long enough, right? But I do want to have the fact that the y goes off to infinity. And then you're looking for transient, so you keep this term. And that's a non-intuitive thing as well, right? Because if you started from the complete non-dimensional, right? If you started from this, remember before I had this, well, this is going to scale like a length divided by a scale velocity. That's what I did way before when I just did the full non-dimensional Navier-Stokes equations. All right? So now, when you did this division, right, everything worked out. But you could zoom into any value of time you wanted, right? This is, right, it could scale like this way, but you could just have any sort of ratio or factor of this. So I could have, you could say, I want to look at time like L times some integer like N, where this doesn't add any units to it, but it scales, it either zooms in or zooms out of the time scale that you want to investigate. Do I want to click my clock in seconds, or click my clock in minutes, or click my clock in hours, like a geothermal flow? So you could do it that way, and then, like for instance here, steady state would infer that the n is blowing up to infinity, and that would give you your steady state assumption, right? Because I'm looking at a very, very long time scale where the n's blowing up. But if I want to zoom in, right, so this I think of me zooming in to a time scale that keeps this term with the viscous term, so I'm looking at the viscous response of the fishy moving in the water, right? This is the problem I model. This is the problem we're modeling. So you're really searching for a time scale such that this holds. You don't have it before. And that's where you come into this issue. Okay? So the first, let's define this very neat system. So I divide out by the rho to get this. Okay? And then I have This is a PDE now. Right? Maybe you haven't seen this in fluids. You usually derive steady state solutions as like just the Poiseuille flow, and that was an ODE. Now the problem is modeled by a partial differential equation. I have two variables here. That makes it a heck of a lot difficult. And one of the boundary conditions, initial conditions, if you have a PDE that has space and time, you need to assign now initial conditions and boundary conditions. You call it initial boundary value problem. Okay, so what do we have? We have, okay, that one is that the plate starts, or the fish starts in completely still liquid, and then boundary conditions being this. Defined system, okay? Almost done, right? Almost done. At least now you should still maybe take a break for a coffee because you at least have reasoning that you have a nice well-defined system and now you need to attack it on how you get a solution for what the U is as a function of time and space, right? Again, we're looking for U as a function of Y and T. That's what we want to find. How does my velocity field change as a function of time and of space when I have impulse motion to still liquid? So there are ways to approach this thing, but there's a really nice way to think about this problem if you again look at these scale things. And again, the scales all help you, right? And scales can be found from taking this simplified model and going in non-dimensional form, okay? So now I would look for a scales for this problem. So look to boundary conditions or initial conditions for a velocity scale. So my U is going to scale like however fast I'm pulling the plate. Not that hard, okay? What's next? So now in that form, I have this, what do you get? You get a U naught out here, non-dimensional time. I don't know what the non-dimensional time is, but I'm gonna say I have it. So you have to be okay sort of not claiming you have things that you don't quite know, because with scaling, sometimes it will just pop out. And then I have this y, right? So I'm trying to do a non-dimensional scale or find some natural maximum for these two things. But the issue being that I can't do that because I can't say, right, that's garbage. So again, we'll just put a dimensional y in there. So this is some continuous sort of value y, and this is a continuous time value. Now, because the equation's linear, I do get this nice property that the velocity scale crosses out. So it won't play a factor if I'm looking for scales of this time or length. And that's even in a scale, even in these scale arguments, you can see the benefit of linear partial differential equations as opposed to nonlinear, right? Because if I had a squared term right there, my velocity scale would be retained within the scale. It just shows you now that it would just, right, even nonlinear of ODEs can be investigated just through the scales of the nonlinearity. Okay, but the question still remains. Squared in there. Okay, how do I assign some sort of scale to the, how do I assign this scale? Well, you just kind of go ahead with it, right? So if this is 1 over time, these things I'm still going to say look like 1. That's a definition of that star notation doing this scaling, right? So then I get this. Okay, and then you get this. Okay, I can find this. So that's a strange relationship that you found right now. You found that, well, this equation will balance, right? Both terms will retain importance in here because these are 1, and I don't want, like, I can't have anything scaled to 0, so I have to keep these. If I have my dimension y scale by the square root of time, right, normalized by a viscosity term, okay? So that's pretty strange, right? So then you could divide both sides by the same thing. You would get that then for an order 1 term, is this, right? Really, this is right, y divided by this. This, you could think, right, this is a non-dimensional length variable. But I like to think of it as an order one term, because what it says is many values, right, of y end of time look like one. Right, this right, if right as time grow, right as time right as time grows, I could treat these variables almost identical. That's what this balance tells you. That I'm trying to solve a PDE, but I found some symmetry in there where I could think of y, where it's not really a function of y end of t. It's really just this one number that I'm tracking. And I'm tracking this ratio, this non-dimensional length. But it's tricky if you think of it as a non-dimensional length, because really it's this function now, right? Right? This is what we call eta, a similarity variable. Right? Eta is a function that you found such that all these values, no matter what y you give me or what time that you give me, I can make this equation balance and be right and measure those dynamics. So this is what we call the similarity variable, right? Right? And this is maybe cueing you into where this type of analysis comes from. And then always, right, and they come from when you don't have a natural scale, right, to pick, at least in one of the dimensions or coordinates. I was driven to this because I had my y blowing up to infinity, and I was trying to investigate, what is the viscous response time of this system of a fish with an impulse motion and still liquid? And to measure both of these size equivalently, I found this relationship where if I have y, I could treat these things like the exact same number. There are many values of y and t where this is true. So that cues me that then this ratio looks like 1. So I have an order 1 variable. Order 1 function. Right, order one variable, and now this thing is also an order one variable. What else do I have? I also have this boundary condition, which maybe is described by the picture I drew, but I have this boundary condition saying that as I go off to infinity with respect to my coordinate system, I want to be zero. So way, way, way above the fish, I have still liquid, because I'm in this intermediate range where the surface doesn't matter, I'm in a still liquid, and maybe there's, right, and I'm, you okay, got it, okay. So this is a natural, I think that's a natural boundary condition that maybe you would get at if you had the problem in front of you. It could also be a submarine, not a fish, right? You could be actually trying to think about like a jerk, like an impulse or jerk accelerations of a submarine in still liquid. It's still the exact same thing. Well, if I zoom in really close, what does shear look like right on that surface? Formulate the same problem, get to the same simplified system. This really is the solution, I believe. But now we're getting a little further, right? Because it's a bit tricky to solve that because it's a PDE. So what we're getting at is we're going to formulate this as an ODE, right? So I'm going to search for my U, scaled, right, non-dimensional U. So this velocity divided by this length velocity scale, which came from a boundary condition, it's how fast the, right, it's how fast the change in acceleration is. I essentially instantaneously go from zero velocity to some velocity. So think of a jolt axon, not physical, but it models physical processes. So this, I'm going to say, is a function of eta. Why would I do that? Well, I did that because, right, if I found an order one variable, well, that's a good, right, this is a variable. This is a function of y and t. So I can track then one variable that looks like just one, right, an order one value, and I can model my dynamics. And these essentially, it combines a bunch of curves, which we'll see in the solution, but it's coming from that you had no other way to do this, right, but to balance both terms, even though y and t were variables. Right, so you have a similarity variable, and then you search for a similarity solution. Okay. Now, an extra credit is show me the same conclusion show show me the exact same conclusion in this non-dimensional form, right? If you just then assume I'm going to look for an equation looks like that. It's really you're saying this. But show me that if you just assume then I'm going to look for a solution that looks like this without ever doing the scaling, you would get this. Right, essentially, starting from here, show constant. It's a fun exercise. And again, always do remember your chain rule and your product rule for this stuff. Okay, so maybe then you understand where these similarity variables are coming from. They come from a necessary need to try to make your problem even simpler. Again, I have a simple PDE system. This is just the heat equation, right? And you can solve this even in a finite domain. I like solving it in a finite domain. But so again, this really is the solution that I've modeled a system and I'm looking for the viscous, and I'm modeling the viscous time response of sudden motion in a still liquid, and I get this. My boundary conditions, closed problem, solve it in Mathematica, MATLAB, Python, however you want to do it. And these are very simple examples. They can get 2D, 3D, maybe they're smaller. But the similarity stuff is nice for this. So assume when we assume that functional form, you then plug it back into the non-dimensional equation. Okay? And I have a Mathematica program that does this, right? So I have so it would save a lot of time, actually, if you just write a Mathematica program that you define a PDE, and then you define something called an ansatz, and then you sub the ansatz into the PDE, and it does all the algebra for you, right? Less error-prone, the symbolic manipulation is done for you. All your brain power is left to do is just think about these weird non-intuitive things, such as, well, I found an order one, how can I break it down into a similarity thing, okay? So when you do that, right, so terms like anything where you see that, right, would end up looking like a d eta like that, right? So a chain rule to make a substitution of what the derivatives look like to get new equations. Do that, eta, and then after you plug this f of eta into this non-dimensional form, you will then derive a new ODE. It looks like this. Right, where a prime notation I'm saying means a d by d eta. So this is important. It's an ordinary differential equation now, not a partial differential equation. And then you transform the boundary conditions for the same exact problem. So this is still 0. No, this is now. Okay. So now this becomes 1. This will become 1 from this condition, because again, this equals, right? So if you non-dimensionalize the functional form, right, you'll get that this non-dimensional function has to equal 1 there. And then you'll combine then these two equations. Right? And then you really just have this one. And this is a combination of which ones? Essentially, these zero terms where eta blows up to infinity, right? So now this is a better solution. Okay, two solutions. Before yelling, it's like, not the solution. You haven't written out what U is. I'm trying to stress to you. So this is a solution, and this is a better solution. right? Because it's a well-defined ordinary differential equation. It's a well-defined PDE, a partial differential equation. These are just harder to solve than this. So this is my ODE, and this is an ODE with boundary conditions. Now, do you see why I had in your homework solve these things? Because these pop up a lot when you come up with a similarity equation, and you get these weird infinite boundary conditions that pop up, right? I mean, eta can go to infinity two ways, and that's something to remember, right? It's defined by a y and then a c naught, and then really a viscous penetration depth is what that can be thought of as, right? So this can blow, right? So as time goes to zero, this will blow up, right? If I go to zero, this goes to infinity, and then similarly, right? So this is that combination that now I've combined two of my limits that were in a boundary condition, that were in a boundary condition and an initial condition, and turned them into one boundary condition. Tricky. Might not intuitive, but I'm just trying to say this all started off from just looking at a fish or all of a sudden having some motion in water. Right, so this is really why I gave you these homework assignments, because if you ever in your career, right, decide to combine down or look for similarity solutions for your PDE, you might end up making a simpler ODE, but you will then create maybe an issue of implementing these boundary conditions for your similarity solution, right? So getting to know how to do that. Maybe some of you realize that it's really just about converting it to an initial value problem for your computer, and then just click on points and see which one works. Hopefully you ask a mathematician, does a solution actually exist and is it unique for my system? And then if it does, you can just go ahead and plug in numbers on your computer and it would, you're getting closer and closer to a solution that you know to exist. But we're engineers, so we don't really care about existence, we just roll along. Hopefully someone just corrects us. But again, this is a better solution because really the solution, right, look it up. You wrote down, right, you've written this down. Right, look up your ODE first. Is there a general solution to this problem? Just the ODE, and then see if you can apply the boundary conditions. Always do that. Don't try to solve an ODE that's been solved. I don't want you to waste effort. Right? People are, you know, there's books of solved ordinary differential equations and some PDE examples, so use them. Okay? And the end of the game for this one is this does have a solution that you can look up in a book and then apply just some boundary conditions, and then you get that is now your solution, right? And it's interesting then to see, I always thought it was strange. I mean, if you really redimensionalizing this, right, this is u as a function of eta is equal to scale right. So again, if you then get closed form things, I always recommend, right, desmos it. See what's happening. So making this a plot where you change y and t as a parameter, you'll see exactly what's happening to this. As this fish moves along, you get this sort of swooping and ever-decaying quadratic slope, or a sloping thing. It's almost like being pulled away from there. But it's fun to actually just plot it and see the combination of the y and t giving you that velocity profile. And it's a good way to maybe understand what it really is showing you. Sorry about that. Right? I think plotting Well, right? Really actually plotting the function as a, right, as a function of y and t at least once in your life is important. Maybe draw that actual surface to see how y and t change the velocity field and how they decay down. I mean, as this right, the error function has a property, as this blows up to infinity, this becomes 1, so then you get the, all the boundary conditions are satisfied. But going through that process of actually plotting these similarity variables, I think is helpful to do at least once to remind yourself that eta is not just eta, right? Eta represents a ratio of time and space, and it's only valid for extremely, right, for it's only valid for extremely small amounts of times or when y and t balance. It all came from me balancing space and time as variables. Okay? So that's, again, that this one falls in the category of simple flows because of what? Because I could simplify the Navier-Stokes equations, right? Simplify the Navier-Stokes equations, get a simple partial differential equation system, then write down an even simpler ODE system via method of a similarity variable. How did I find the similarity variable? Well, I just attempted to scale, right? I just made an attempt to try to scale y and time. I left them arbitrary as functions and realized, well, the ratio of the space variable and the time variable looks like the number 1. So I could just track that ratio as a differential equation and get a solution. So now let's do another dynamic problem. And this is the dirtiest trick I've ever seen. I hate this one because I just have no way. I don't have a way to show you how this would ever happen. So now you could have an imagination where you're shaking the bottom of a plate. So now I want to do this thing where this is going to oscillate. Oscillation problems. So before I just had instantaneous velocity imposed on a surface, so essentially a fish moving still, then immediately goes into some velocity, and it looked at the transition of the velocity field, right, as it moved at that constant rate. But now let's say you have, I don't know, some sort of shaking device, right, where you can shake the bottom of your surface. It's big enough and wide enough, let's say. Again, always have this thing, right? Surface effects, if this is air, and this is now the liquid, there'd be some surface effects, right? The boundary, right? These dynamics would percolate into the liquid after some distance. Then there's, let's say, an area when it really everything dies out due to viscous forces. This is when it is zero, right? Notice I'm writing the material derivative here too, by the way. And now I have this thing where I'm modeling like a shaking plate of some sort of oscillation. It could be like an Intel or microchannel fluidic flows like that. Maybe you want to oscillate things to create some mixing. Right? Maybe you want to oscillate things to impose some sort of energy, heat the thing up. I don't really care. But you're really concerned with how far up do those dynamics matter. So I want to see, depending on how much I oscillate, so I'll call this a U0 omega t, right? Omega t, because now this is a non-dimensional input to the sine function. Okay, so my right. So the condition here being a dynamic one, where I oscillate the bottom plate, and I'm asking you to tell me, right, the dependence of the liquid I have in this oscillation. How can I get this oscillation effects, right, to go up in, right, furthest up into the liquid? What's that dependence? Can you tell me? Let's say you're shaking to mix things, or you're however you want to doing it. Or you're trying to minimize this length. I mean, clearly you could not oscillate. Clearly you could not oscillate, and you would have no right effect of this boundary. Or maybe you have some specific length that you're shooting for. Could you tell me that right off the bat? Could you even run a CFD program and tell me this? I don't think you could. I think it would take you quite a while, actually, to run this immediately and get the right answer. Because you would need the right boundary conditions in the cylinder and the domain that you apply. You need to somehow make an even, you need to somehow create this boundary condition. Somehow it could be a radial one. It could be, you know, oscillating inward and outward. There are many boundary conditions you have to assign to get this right, and I just think it's pretty darn difficult. If you've never heard this before, if you ever have a physical problem and you have a sine function modeling it, you need to have a frequency. And the need for that is because sine can't have any units, right? So remember that sine has a power series expansion, right? This function is the same thing as this infinite sum, 1 over n, or the odd ones, right, of the argument to the n. Okay? So with a frequency in there, I have time divided by time, and I have no units, so I'm good. But if you don't have the frequency in there, then you would have time seconds squared, seconds to the third power, seconds to the fourth, and you would have to have an infinite number of physical coefficients that make it a non-dimensional statement. So if you ever have a physical problem and you're modeling it with a sine function, you always must have the frequency in there. And then you can use that frequency to reference something. Frequency is the measure of a hertz, right? A per unit oscillation. It models how much of the oscillating thingy I have. Okay, so we're going to jump right to it then again. So same system, same assumptions will apply. And really, just like I had done before, everything's exactly the same. Right? Zero is still less than infinity, so it sort of falls in the category. But leaving this less than infinity also helps you assume more. Because you could have a resonance where you could actually make the top surface, actually oscillate with the fluid, and you just want that velocity to be finite. I mean, really there's some cutoff value here based on other physics, but it's just more general enough, right? Where if there's some, maybe there's some oscillations where this value can go all the way up, and even the top surface as y goes off to an infinity could have a finite velocity. So this is just a finiteness boundary condition. Okay, how would you get there? Again, all I have done is I've just changed this boundary condition. So again, I have a PDE that models my system. I have an initial condition, the initial condition being still liquid. I start off completely steady. I start off with just still liquid in my system, and then here are BCs, boundary conditions, which are modeling error things. So what did I say before and always going to say? This is a solution, right? You can go further with it for sure because you can actually solve things like this. But even here, right, it's a simple example and it's been solved, but if it was very, very much more complex, if you wrote down the governing equations, which are a simplified version of Navier-Stokes equations, you got a solution, right? You have found a way to describe u of x, right? You have found the definition of u of y and t, right? I have modeled now the viscous response of this frequency based on these equations, right? So there's a diffusion of this time transience, this diffusion, right, where viscous forces are diffusing as they go up. So momentum is getting diffused by viscosity as you go further and further away from the plate. But you can keep going. So now let's do the non-dimensionalization type thing, and you have now scales, right? So I have a scale for time and velocity. Right, this is going to scale. Right, like one of velocity, and then look to your boundary conditions or initial conditions for a for a velocity value. I have a u naught there, and then what's left is the y. But then y can also be scaled by this value. Okay, so I do have some scale for the right. I do have some scale. Right, because I have a unit of time to scale by. So you could maybe stop right there. But let's keep going, right? So again, I did have an infinite case in the y in this problem, which is what I want to highlight. I do have y going up to infinity. But because I have this unit of 1 over time and this unit of viscous forces, I do have this velocity scale. You can just do it, actually. If you put in the non-dimensional form here, since you did have a time scale, you could then solve for the y. Okay? And this is a scale relation. You get back to your manager real quickly going like, I'm pretty sure it's just this, right? It's like penetration depths are probably right, viscosity divided by the frequency. So go along and you could maybe get an estimate of this. Okay, we want to do better, so then we do better modeling. So our trick we do, right, is the non-dimensional system looks like this. So non-dimensional system, you'll have boom. So the same thing, it's pretty. This is time. This is also zero, and then boundary condition now. This is very simple. Right? So it's a lot simpler because you're just having like these pure math things. I mean, it doesn't look too much different. Right, I mean, it's not. Nothing really at all there. That's impressive. But then you just have this system. Now there are ways to do that, but the problem of dealing with a semi-infinite domain problem in a PDE, right? There's kind of two ways to do this. So the more rigorous way is if you have a semi. Semi-infinite domain PDEs, right, are, right, if they're linear too, very important. So linear semi-infinite domain problems, right, the semi-infinite being that y went from zero all the way up to infinity. So I have a semi-infinite domain problem. These correspond to methods of really a Fourier. Fourier transform methods. But I don't think it's. I don't think it's. There's a requirement of this class that you've ever even had to take the PDE course. So technically, you have to find a way to do it without that. And this is the dirty trick. The dirty trick being, right. Again, right. I've told you the solution, right. We're just trying to mathematically now solve this problem. So the dirty trick being that you see that I have to satisfy this sine function, right, for y equal to t. So you can interpret this a different way. Like this. Right? And I don't know how on earth you would actually ever think to do this. But if I just see sine of t, and you know that there's the right, the Euler, right, this the classic formula, right? Right, this is just that classic relationship between sines, cosines, imaginary values, and exponents. So if you write, if you have this in your mind, you can go like, I could take the imaginary part. So you could just have this right idea that, right, the initial condition, right, the boundary condition at zero, I could think of it as the imaginary part of some function, right? Yeah, because it's non-dimensional, right? You think of the imaginary part of some complex function. Right? So then you go to your educated guess thing where you go, well, now I'm going to look for a solution that looks like this. Okay, dirty trick, I think, because there's no way to really motivate. Really, you would do a Fourier transform of the semi-infinite problem. You could find basically the same result, but this is, I don't know, on Earth. I mean, now you have an imaginary. But it's just, right, it's just trickery that I'm doing to really figure out my velocity field. So same thing, plug this thing back into there, you'll then get this governing equation. There's a negative in there. Right, you then get this governing equation. There's a negative on there. Where'd it go? Okay. So it's negative. And then left over, because of how exponent differentiation works, this is left over. Okay, so now just from making this assumption or the educated guess method of solving a partial differential equation or ordinary differential equation, you arrive at this new equation. Again, I'm only looking now for f of y. I've already determined what the other part, or the time-varying part, is. So you're looking for the f part. So then you get this relationship, and you go, okay, then this needs to be 0. So I've simplified it even more. Okay. Okay. So now this must be 0 because this was a non-zero number. It has to be 0 for all the time. Okay, well then you then can calculate out this non-dimensional solution. I don't care how you do it, right? Use your tools to look up dsolve. Dsolve will look for analytic solutions of ordinary differential equations. Go ahead and search it. He ends up getting this relationship, and you solve for these, right? You solve for these boundary conditions, right? And then you apply the boundary conditions that we have up there. And then you would get right. You would get that the actual function is the imaginary part of this expression. Right? A dirty trick. Just terrible. But right, if you were somehow motivated to do that, then I guess you would be a genius. Again, you don't have to be this genius. If you could look up in your problem, maybe on the web, you go, it looks like I have a semi-infinite domain PDE. How would I end up solving that? So I'm trying to stress that you maybe wouldn't even need to do this, right? Because if you did write this system down correctly, you would have better terminology to search for how to get a solution. Again, if you searched, how do I solve the heat equation in a semi-infinite domain with a time-varying boundary condition, you would come up with a solution even. But this is just a way to show you that you can trick, or we can do math trickery to get your solution. So now you have this expression right here that tells you the decay in terms of non-dimensional y as I go up in my my fluid field. I have the velocity here, and everything works out, right? Y star equaling 0, I would get my, right, I get this boundary condition of oscillation, and then the transients and everything else is encoded in there. Okay? And then you really have a better estimation of the decay, right? Right, so you will actually die out to 0 based on this term right here. This term is what's governing the decay of it because I have an exponent to a negative power. And then this is the oscillation part here. So this idea then, or the question that you were posed, right, is what is the effect of this, right? What's the penetration depth of that oscillation is really all encoded in this part right here. So you then need to define, well, then what is 0 for me? What am I going to say 0? So some people, this is sort of like you need to arbitrarily say, well, how about, you know, this to the negative 4 is 0 enough for what I'm concerned, that I'm concerned, right? You can make it 10 or 5. But you would just put some integer value in there to make this stuff easy, right? Really, this rate, so exponent, right, e to the negative something will decay down to 0. So you have to really measure what you mean by no velocity. Maybe non-measurable, set it equal to the value 4. Okay, if that's what you're trying to get at, then you have exponent negative 4 is my 0, and then okay, so that means the arguments on the input must be the same. Okay, and then redimensionalize the y, right? Remember that my y value was this. And now you have a better, right? Now you have a much better answer for your boss. And then I have this. Where'd it go? Yeah. So I've just moved this over, right? And then, right, all of that, really, all that trickery, really, to come back with this idea of how far up does this oscillation matter, right? Past this length scale here of, I mean, 4 is just put there because that's how you're going to say that's what 0 is. That's good enough for me. Oh, my time. I'm going to finish early. Yes. And you're even confirmed too, because when I just did the scale for velocity, right, when I just did the scale for the y, right, I got this, right? So at this point, it should be almost comical that why on earth should I even do any of the math? It seems that I can just turn my partial differential equations just into algebraic statements based on parameters to get good enough answers. But, you know, you shouldn't really think that because of this. Square root of 2 is like 1.45, and then, you know, this number scales up a little bit more. So if you're trying to be very, very, very precise, you would really want to look for this value. And there's no way to do that value except through the actual, like, analytical stuff or make a plot to get it, right? So that's what I was saying about, like, doing this in CFD is actually even hard as well, because you'd have to set up your system, right? And you could stop maybe even at the scales, right? You could just have this relationship, well, I know that y star scales like this value, and then you'd have to do a bunch of runs to figure out what that is. And maybe it would get around to the 4 square root 2. And it does. I did that once. It blows my mind. Okay. So that's the dirty trick of fluids, I think. It's still a simple incompressible flow because it's dynamic, but I could write down a solution. So simple in our eyes. No approximation needed. We could actually write down what the total solution is. All right. Maybe you did the actual 2D radial problem, where I did the rigorous simplification based on 2 dimensions of the Navier-Stokes equations with my scales, non-dimensionalized my gradient operator, found that I had the 1 over Reynolds and it was, right, scales worked out as well. And maybe you have maybe you now have the radial problem set up. So this is an interesting problem of irrotational incompressible or radial vortex flow. So a vortex flow is something that we talk about where you have a situation, right, it's like the really, it goes down all the way to infinity, right? Where we use this coordinate system like this. This is the z. This would then be the r coordinate. And then you have pure swirl velocity, right? So a vortex, we can imagine it totally always as just a total vortex being just things going around in a circle, a perfect vortex. Will never decay inward. It's just concentric circles. It doesn't actually exist, but it's pretty close. Right, it's a pretty close model depending on the problem that you have. All right. So, sort of around here towards this top, there's this ideal flow solution. It's transitional, and then there's sort of this area when I get so small that I need to have viscous effects there, right? Ideal, right? An ideal flow means that, right, this is saying, right, the viscosity is equal to 0. Or you have an irrotational flow. That's an irrotational assumption. Now, later, when we do potential flows, I will show you, right, we will see that the swirl velocity in the ideal case, lost the cap. The swirl velocity in the ideal case is only a function of r and is equal to some number called a circulation, 1 over r relationship. And this is for the ideal case. Right? And this is a circulation value, and it comes from an integral over a line. So however you have some line right here, there's some line, right, there's some surface integral you do, you can calculate what the vortex strength is. Again, we'll get here when we do potential flows. But you can already see there's an issue here with this solution, that issue being, right, as r goes to 0, I now have an infinite velocity. Right, so if I shrink down further and further and further in this fluid, it does look like that if you look at vortices, right, or vortex flow, where it can go round and round. If something goes further down, it starts spinning really, really, really rapidly. But then if it gets down to the actual bottom or at some level, you will see that it just stops in its place, and there's no more swirl velocity, or at least that it's finite, or that's actually, it's zero. All right, so that's that transition of going from this ideal flow, maybe a small transitional flow where the scales balance, and then going into this flow where the viscous part's going to matter. Okay, so my notes, I'm almost done, it's almost Friday, and I'm almost out of here. All right, so from this, if you had the radial one, you would get this, you get this relationship, similar to what we already had, right? It's very classic in fluid classes where I do Cartesian and you have to do radial problems because radial is slightly harder. And I always hated that as a student. But man, when I'm teaching this, I'm sick of doing radials, so same thing for you. I'll have you do the radials. I get to do the Cartesians for once. All right, so this goes down to 0. These are now 0. And you get that, this conclusion. Very similar. I'm only doing this a little briefly. We'll maybe do more advanced flows later. But for these simple flows, I don't count rotational flows as simple because I just can't, I just hate that, whatever. I just don't like it. So, right, this is the same type of conclusion, where that means that the swirl velocity in the incompressibility condition is not a function of the angle that I'm at. If you're rotating around, it doesn't matter what angle I've swept through, right? It could be 0 to 2 pi. It's not a function of that. Wherever, right, whatever angle you're at, they have the same velocity, constant relationship. And this is sort of a strange thing where we think of rotational flows, right? Where we can think of a flow like this, where rotational having like having vortices effects in there. But the thing is, if something rotates around a pure circle, this is why we say ideal. Keep rotating. This is a classic image of this type of flow for a vortice flow, right? And this is when r is going to 0, right? So this is some finite r. And if I'm at a finite r, this flow is only a swirl velocity. So this is going to be v theta, right? It's not equal to 0. So any control volume I draw doesn't have actually any shearing motion associated to it, because the outer is balanced by the inner. So however much this would have expanded, because of conservation of angular momentum, this ends up rotating faster, and you keep the same control volume as you go down. So that's why you call it an ideal case, because if there's no deformation of our control volumes, remember when we derived the Navier-Stokes, the deformations is that Newtonian fluid, so it involves viscous forces. So an irrotational flow, if it's irrotational, it's equivalent to saying that there's no viscous shearing effects. Again, ideal. So what do we get next? And then you have your momentum. So that was from here. And then we get the swirl of momentum. And I want to keep the time. No pressure gradient either, right? Only pressure you have is the same thing we've done before. The y, right, the z momentum pressure, right, the z momentum equation you would have, all you would derive is that the pressure is just the hydrostatic pressure there, and I have no added. So again, if I'm at angle 0 and I look at angle pi, they both have the exact same, right, hydrostatic pressure, so there's no pressure gradient in that swirl. So there's no added effect for the motion. So that won't happen. Keeping a transience, because I'm trying to look at the transition regime that's going on. OK, that's good. What are our boundary conditions? Well, we want to recover this swirl velocity, right? Swirl velocity as I go down into a very deep area where viscous forces, right, where the viscous force recovers, or even actually if I go right down to the bottom of the plate here, okay, this I still will have no slip. So it's a boundary condition. We're here, it's zero. So that's one boundary condition. What else do I have? Well, I also want, as I grow and grow in my radial coordinate, right, what should this be? Well, if I'm in an ideal vortex, if I grow out my radius, right, that's equivalent to saying I go further and further out and I get to this ideal case, the ideal case being this. Okay, so that ideal vortex is what we're looking at. Pi r. Anything else we have? Okay. Say it with me. I got my PDE. I got a boundary conditions. What else do I need? And that initial condition, baby. Okay, so then here, initial condition being time equals zero. What do I have there? Well, I also have swirl. Right? So now I have my IC. Solution. Right? Pitter-patter, get at her. However you want to do it. But again, there's going to be a trick here. The trick being that similarity problem. Okay? And how are you going to get that similarity? Same thing we've always done before, right? We're going to attempt to non-dimensionalize, get stuck, and just overcome by the gull of our teeth. Okay? So I want to measure dynamics of time, balancing this radial portion, right? So I'm looking at the transition region when viscous becomes important. So I go down and down and down. There's now a transition of this spinning vortice, right? And there's a transition region where I must have, where time must become introduced into the problem and then decay down to zero. Okay? Very hard to maybe rationalize, but you're just trying to think about this transitional region where I just had an ideal flow. I went past the point, I went down, but I'm trying to get down to here. So there's some time variable because I had levels of constant rotational swirl velocity, but then the time where some component had to kill it down to zero when I get down to the bottom. Okay. So that means I'm looking for a time scale where this whole thing is still there. So now I'm going to sort of show you how I do these things in my own time. I don't even use the inputs, right? I sort of just, okay. And then you'll see that this is okay. What have I told you this whole time over and over again? If you get them into this form, right, this is the point of that. You're saying, well, in an approximate regime or in limiting cases, these operators even look like the identity operator. So the theory of justifying a lot of things that we're doing with this scale stuff is actually proving that's true. That this operation of differentiation, if you get down to these scales, it looks like the, never mind, whatever. Okay, so now this is what I'm trying to behave. What do you get? You get a surprisingly similar result, right? You already saw this, right? So I have an R scales now, like this. So maybe you say to yourself, right, and don't leave capital R. I do have to remind myself to do this where I go. This is actually a little r because it's a function, right? It's a function. So this is what you get. You go, aha, I can find an order one variable. I can find values of time and values of radii where this just looks like a number, a scalar number, right? These balance. So these are values of radius and values of time. So really small times, really large radii. This quantity I can track like a variable. Now that we're really advanced in simple flows and we just go jump right to things, we say, well, in my non-dimensional case, what is a scale by two, right? What did I tell you all the time, right? Look to your boundary conditions and initial conditions first for your velocity scales. A good exam problem I've sometimes seen is people, I won't do this because I'm telling you, right, is they'll tell you to like search for the scale such that these are balancing, and really the answer is looking at you right in the face, but you'll spin gears trying to look for that internal velocity scale, right? The whole point being the idea that, right, you're not looking at your boundary, your initial conditions first. Yes, it's true there are sometimes an internal velocity scale, but look to these first. Okay, so what does this say? Well, it's, well, including the R in there, I get this. Right? I know there's a R in there, but just jump for joy and just go for it. Okay, now you have that well-formed problem where now I'm looking for a non-dimensional swirl velocity, and I'll call that F as a function of eta. What have I done? I've reduced my partial differential equation down to an ordinary differential equation. You chug the gears of algebra with Mathematica, and now you derive this transform your boundary conditions and initial conditions. Again, we will get 2 here. Again, solved. Here's a better system. Here's a better solution. Okay? Before, this was my solution in terms of a partial differential equation, but since I had semi-infinite domains, this is actually a better solution. Right? Everything will be encapsulated in this. So what do we do? If I had my class here, I would pause a lot and I would want to hear everyone repeat this. When you get to this step, what do you do? You look it up. Look to see if this has been solved. If it's been solved, you're in luck. If it's not, then maybe you get a paper published from somewhere. But don't do unnecessary work. Look it up. And you're in luck, right? Because it does have a solution. Right? So that's that. Similarities already between the radial problem we had and now this situation. There's a flip, right? In the Raleigh problem, we had a very similar ODE we derived. We just didn't have a 1 over eta relationship. In a swirl problem, because you have 1 over r relationships, you'll always get a 1 over coordinate problem. So you have a solution. Looks like this. Right? You can redimensionalize now. And now describe everything about that swirl velocity in terms of the function of time and of space. And this is an ocean vortex. Okay? And there's a bunch more. This is part of a family of solutions of other types that you could go into with similar results. Whatever you model this idea that there's some regime right now where viscous forces had to dominate where I went down. My only assumptions I had was I know that as my radius goes further out, that I must have this ideal case. This we'll get to later in the class with potential flows, but let's say you just knew that, and you're trying to see what is this time dissipation rate, right, of these types of plots. And I can't do this on the board, but again, when you get things like this, all about that Desmos, baby. Right, check out what these curves are doing and internalize them. What does it look like they're doing? So this is an interesting one with the swirl velocity now. You have some initial circulation power, right? Remember that the eta has this property where both time and space make it go to zero. Or make it, right? So something going to zero can, something going to zero, something infinite can make this thing go to infinity. And all the dynamics actually end up being there. So as eta blows up to infinity, what happens here? It goes down to 1. Everything's there. Those are some simple flows. I've shown you the point of what I think a fluid analysis is for these simple cases where, right, you're trying to go from the Navier-Stokes equations down to a much simpler system and then solve that system. So some people, this is maybe my flavor on the class, because people like Mark and other people, they don't like it, you know, something being that maybe they don't like the idea that maybe the system is just a pure math problem. My interpretation is there are so many questions to do, and I'm not a genius, and I can't understand all this physical intuition, that until I get to that point when I can just internalize the viscous forces and I can see the ideal case coming, et cetera, right? I'm going to work on this way, where I non-dimensionalize rigorously, and there's almost a path for me to do that, right? I just look at my problem and then make it non-dimensional, and then I get my conclusions from there. And then if I solve my non-dimensional problem, which is just a problem about numbers, there's no even units associated to it, well, that's the math world. Solve it in the math world somehow, and then redimensionalize my problem, and then I can get to interpreting things, right? Maybe 20 years from now, every bit of math can be physical for me, but I think that's a learned thing, right? We can teach kids to do algebra, so I will leave it at that, okay? Certainly, if you want to take your own notes when it comes to these things and do the physical step every single time, go right ahead. But I love the beauty of the fact that when it comes to defining this very simple system, you can look it up, it doesn't matter how you get the solution, bam, get the solution, then it's just a matter of just redimensionalizing things. It's amazing. Okay, so that is simple incompressible flows. Simple meaning that we can write an actual form down. Right? Simple meaning, yes, you could look it up. I didn't go into how you solve these things, but again, you can just Wolfram Alpha and see the steps for how they are. Does anybody even care how to get the solutions anymore? Does anyone actually care about solving differential equations by hand anymore? Maybe on weekends, but I don't have time for that anymore. Okay, so we're going to get more advanced next, but for most of, I think almost all the homeworks, this methodology works. Right. All the homeworks are made, really, of me, drawing geometries and then going through this process of scale and then making some statement about something that's small or something that is zero. So limiting cases are very important. So next we do more advanced flows. I have cut the compressible flow example because the class was not interested, it seemed like. We're not even looking at that. So that process, I took a long time to do that 2D flow because I was trying to show you how you might approach a problem that you have no idea how to solve. All you got is geometry, so use those scales somehow in that math. And then amazing symmetries. I think it's a good exercise. I didn't assign it because, I think it could be rough, I think, of doing that same process of a 2D flow and showing that a radial flow is the same thing with the scales involved. Is a nice process. So I hope that an example of going maybe from the rigorous, I know nothing and get all of the Poiseuille flow, all of the Couette flow in a generalized solution. And I hope you enjoyed seeing dynamics in solutions finally. So next is the advanced flows, and I will show you a fantastic closed form solution for flow in a duct. Right? You can actually write a solution down for this. I'm not saying that one's simple, though. Right? You can write flow down here, and it just looks like a bullet or a Mario Kart bullet. Right? So because there's a symmetry in there. But next, we'll actually be able to solve for the flow if this is H and this is L. And essentially, we're going to be able to solve it if these are kind of the same. Wait, no, not L, W, right? Remember how in 2D, right? In 2D, I made W go infinitely far in both directions, so there was no natural scale there. Well, here, we'll see how to actually get the flow rate and the velocity profiles in a square duct. That means this assumption that these scales balance. They're almost the same. A rectangle, 2 to 4, it's good enough. Okay, so I'm done. I'm at 2 hours. I'm going to have a great Friday. I hope you do as well. Happy Friday.
Trying to Yeah, exactly.
You should not be putting this on your channel.
From it, like,
what?
Shatter is a thing, but that's...